Quest Audiobooks presents an unabridged recording of Death on Damson Island by Jay Gill. Narrated by Sam Booth. An extract from the diary of H.K. Fleming, Esquire. I have arrived on Damson Island as a guest of Mr. Randall Dobson, theatre owner, director, and businessman. The only residential property on the island is Damson House, a large, white, magnificent building where Randall intends to continue rehearsals and focus the minds of his cast on their forthcoming play. From what I've seen so far, the island is desolate, yet beautiful. For such a small piece of land off the south coast of England, it makes quite an impact with its imposing cliffs and jagged rocks. Weather permitting, I look forward to some interesting walks. The boat trip across was uneventful, despite the sea being rather choppy. It's apparent a storm is imminent, and the boat captain, a weather-worn chap who goes by the name of Nelson, has suggested we make ourselves comfortable in the house, and, metaphorically speaking, batten down the hatches. Indeed, as Nelson predicted, the storm whipped itself to a frenzy of howling wind that thrashed the heaving waves against the shore, lightning ripping the sky with ear-splitting cracks, the likes of which I have rarely experienced. We are now cut off from the mainland, and there has been a murder. Single bullet to the back of the head, small caliber pistol. Today has been taxing. I questioned guests, made notes. Once again, I find myself amid another grave and complex mystery. There have, however, been some interesting and quite enlightening insights. I must further question the suspects. This morning, I must reveal my findings. I am both shocked and saddened by what I must do here. As a student of human nature, it bears repeating that I am constantly surprised by it. Act 1. The cast is assembled. Chapter 1. The train station. England, 1923. Audrey Warren sat at a small table beside a window in the station cafe, toying with the white gloves in her hand. Today's meeting with Charles Lockwood had been something she'd longed for, but had repeatedly shied away from. Time and again, she'd put pen to paper, then, having read the words committed to the page, had screwed the letter into a ball and tossed it aside. Eventually, throwing caution to the wind, she decided there was no choice. If she didn't see him, she couldn't move forward with her life. Sitting across the table from him now, she saw how silly she'd been. He was tall, handsome, and blonde, with the most piercing blue eyes. Slightly older than she'd thought, but that didn't matter. Despite her reservations, she realized he'd been just as keen to meet her, something she hadn't anticipated. Now, in an effort to get to know her better, he was actively arranging to spend time with her, making her feel special. "I've asked my agent, Norman Pottersmith, to find you a place to stay. So go home now, pack whatever you need, and catch the first train back to London. But listen, Audrey, Pottersmith doesn't know about us, and I think it's better that way. At least for now, our relationship should remain private." "I understand." Audrey had eyes only for him and he for her. "I still can't believe it. I'm so very excited about spending more time with you. We can really get to know each other now." Charles Lockwood placed his hand gently over hers, where it rested on the table, and stroked it lightly with his thumb. "I don't want you to think for a moment that I'm not proud of you and longing to show you off. That's not why I want to keep us a secret. It's just that, as I'm married, things will need to be handled delicately. And while we get to know each other better, the fewer people who know, the less complicated the whole situation will be. All I'm certain of is that, whatever it takes, I want you in my life." I don't care about the secrecy. I've dreamt of being close to you for such a long time, and now it's finally happening. That's all that matters. Charles drew his eyebrows together.
I'm ashamed to admit, I've done things in my past that I'm not proud of, and behaved in ways that were less than gentlemanly or honourable. But that's all behind me now. I intend to make a fresh start, and that's because of you. You're the most important person in my life. I've honestly never known a feeling like this before. And I plan on telling Eileen, my wife. But I need to pick the right time. I don't know how she's going to react. Though the truth is, I don't care anymore. The only thing that matters is having you near me from now on. Tears filled Audrey's eyes.
I really don't want to go back home. The train journey's going to be awful. I want to stay here with you. Now we've found each other, I just don't want to let you go.
Audrey's train pulled into the station. Reluctantly, they made their way out of the cafe, and Charles drew her into his arms, holding her tenderly.
You mustn't worry. I'll make all the arrangements, he whispered. We'll be together soon enough.
Good heavens, Henry Fleming exclaimed.
Oh, my word! Is that really you, Henry?
Gasped Lady Mabel Garfield.
What on earth brings you to London? An investigation, perhaps?
Believe it or not, I've been sightseeing.
You may recall my housekeeper, Mrs. Clayton. I've been showing her the sights, and now she's back at our hotel, quite exhausted. It seems she's only been to the city a handful of times when a child, and I think she's quite overwhelmed.
Do you have time for tea, Mabel?
Unfortunately, no. I've been running errands and must get home, said Lady Mabel, looking disappointed. I've a young actress staying at the moment. She's performing in a new play with me that's due to be staged in the West End. Between ourselves, she's quite a handful. I'm merely letting her a room, but somehow I now feel responsible for her. She grew up in a small village, and when she first arrived, she seemed a timid little thing. However, the city's quickly transformed her into a rather wayward young lady.
Times have changed, said Fleming. Is it a new play?
She nodded. Rehearsals are underway at the moment, and we're set to open in a few weeks. As you know, I'd all but given up on acting. I'm not the young woman I once was. However, it seems the stage is in my blood, because when Randall Dobson, the director, asked me to audition for a central role, I found I just couldn't say no. She smiled mischievously.
I have an idea. Why don't you join us tomorrow for the dress rehearsal? You could bring Mrs. Clayton.
She's catching a train first thing in the morning and returning to Avonbrook Cottage. She has an engagement with some friends in the village. Plus, of course, she doesn't like to be away from Skip, my dog, for too long. Lewis, the head gardener, is looking after him, but Mrs. Clayton thinks of Skip as her child and sorely misses him.
Henry rubbed his chin.
I myself plan on being in the city for a few more days, though.
Lady Mabel beamed.
Then come along after you've waved her off. You can watch the performance, give your honest opinion, and then we could have dinner. I know a wonderful restaurant that's just opened. It's been far too long since we had a really good natter. You're always so busy, and this is a perfect opportunity.
The sitting room of Leonard Birch's small South Kensington flat felt comfortable and warm. Eileen Lockwood was tempted to stay longer, but knew that would be a mistake.
"Surely you don't need to leave right now," said Leonard. "Why catch the train when you could stay here another hour? I'll drive you home later."
"Charles will be home soon. He might ask questions about where I've been."
"So what if he does? Tell him you've been visiting a friend.
It's not like he cares about you."
He put out a hand and took hers.
"It's beyond me why you won't leave him. The way he treats you breaks my heart.
You deserve so much better.
She pulled her hand away and stood up. I should go.
I'm sorry, Eileen, said Leonard, but you know I have feelings for you. I just wish you'd leave him, for your own sake, if nothing else. You'd be away from all his nonsense, and I'd look after you, you know I would. It's what I want, and deep down I'm certain it's what you want too. I really don't understand why it's so difficult to tell him you're leaving. Charles only cares about himself, surely you can see that. Whenever he upsets you, you come running to me. It feels like I put you back together again, only for you to return to him. It hardly seems fair. Eileen glared. Is that how you see it? Are you telling me you deserve something in return? That you've earned the right to have me? I didn't know you viewed our friendship in that way. What exactly is it you're expecting from me, Leonard?
I didn't mean it like that. Look, just be my friend. If you need more, then, I'm sorry, I simply can't give it. I'm married, and that means something to me.
She walked towards the front door. I'm going to be late for my train.
Leonard spoke softly. Please, let me drive you to the station.
She hesitated a moment, then looked at him fondly. Oh, if you like. I do care about you, my dear, but I won't leave him. It's simply something I can't do. In spite of everything, I love him.
I understand what you're saying, but I want you to know that if you change your mind, the two of us will be quite comfortable, financially speaking, I mean. I have considerable savings. We could do whatever we wanted. Travel the world, go wherever you'd like. If someday I simply can't take it anymore, I'll find a way, but I'll do it on my own terms. She gave Leonard a hug. It means we must remain as friends. Do you understand?
Leonard nodded.
Knowing how he treats you is hard to bear, but I understand. He took her hand and kissed it gently. Friends it is. I'd rather have you in my life than not at all.
Chapter 2. A deal is struck.
If you want my advice, said Lady Mabel.
B. Arling sighed and raised her eyebrows.
Which I don't, though I'm sure you're going to give it anyway.
You'll stay away from Charles Lockwood. Not only is he married, but he also has an unsavory reputation as a hard-drinking ladies' man, a gambler, and a filthy-tempered chauvinist. Charles and I are just friends. We're going for drinks and dancing, then he's taking me for dinner. That's all.
Lady Mabel frowned.
You take me for a fool? I've known Charles Lockwood a very long time, and if I can promise you one thing, it's this. He'll break your heart and leave your reputation in tatters. Despite anything he might say to the contrary, he has no intention of leaving his wife. Eileen's a lovely woman who deserves better. For some unfathomable reason, she turns a blind eye to his love affairs, and numerous other shortcomings. Believe you me, B, he's no gentleman.
I've told you it's nothing. We're just having fun. He's showing me the sights of London, and there's no more to it than that.
She gave Lady Mabel a hug.
I understand you're looking out for me, and I truly appreciate it, but I'd like to drop the subject now, please, if you don't mind.
Lady Mabel wasn't ready to drop the subject.
What about Gino Sadler? He's a charming young man and clearly very attracted to you. He knows London just as well as Charles Lockwood, and unlike Charles, he's not married.
B shook her head.
Gino's a darling. I'm meeting him and Joseph Timms for drinks, too, before dinner with Charles. A man like Gino won't stick around forever. Then where will you be?
You make it sound as though I'm an old maid. I'm still young and want to have fun.
It's not like in your day, Lady Mabel. Times have changed, and a girl can do whatever she wants with whomever she chooses. We want to enjoy ourselves, dress up, cut our hair, drink a little, dance a little, and enjoy falling in love. She giggled.
I need to get changed and do my hair and makeup, or else I'll be late. I'm meeting the boys in an hour.
Randall Dobson and Norman Pottersmith sat in a dismal Fleet Street pub. Gloomy, with little natural light, the air was stale and smelled of sweat, smoke, and beer.
The man's a complete disaster. And in any case, the play's already too far into rehearsals. I can't change the lead now, snapped Randall. Come off it. That's just an excuse, and you know it. Lockwood's unreliable. He spends most of his time drunk, chasing the actresses, and annoying the hell out of everyone else. I've worked with him in the past and vowed never again. So, listen carefully, Norman. My answer is no. Lockwood will not be a part of my production. I want Gino to stay as lead.
Gino's a great young actor, of that there's no doubt. The problem is, he doesn't yet have the pulling power of someone like Charles Lockwood. You and I both know that it's Lockwood's reputation, including his antics off stage, that brings in the audiences, countered Pottersmith.
I'm not suggesting I would, but let's suppose, just for a moment, that I did allow him to take the lead role instead of Gino. How on earth would I tell the lad?
Leave that to me. I'm Gino's agent as well as Lockwood's. It won't be pretty, but Gino listens to me. He has to.
Norman, what on earth does Lockwood have on you that makes you so determined to see him in the lead role?
That has nothing to do with you.
Randall shook his head.
No, I can't do it. In fact, I won't do it. This play has my name attached to it. And if it sinks without trace, it'll be the end for me.
You worry too much. It won't fail.
Why should I listen to a word you say?
Pottersmith smirked.
Because I know about Mimi Wilder?
Randall's eyes widened with shock.
Don't you threaten me with that! I helped Charles. Don't you dare throw that in my face!
Ah, but in helping him, you also helped yourself, didn't you?
I don't owe that wretched man a thing. We were even a long time ago. He knows it, and so do you.
You lied, Randall. You might have ended up behind bars or swinging at the end of a rope. Instead, you're rich and the darling of the West End. I'd say you can afford to do me this favor. We wouldn't want the story to reach the newspapers now, would we?
Randall scowled. He stared at his pint of ale and picked at the chipped table.
This is the last time. After this, we're done. I never want to hear from either you or Charles again.
Thank you, grinned Pottersmith.
I need this, Randall, and so do you, even if you don't yet realize it. Charles wants his career back and has sworn to be on his best behavior. We both know that having his name associated with the play will have the punters flocking to the West End from all over. Once you've done me this favor, we're all fair and square.
You'd better mean it.
You have my word. And stop worrying. He's a changed man.
The club was noisy with music, laughter, and excited voices. The tables around the dance floor were littered with cocktail glasses and crowded with couples taking a rest from dancing.
Stay for another drink. It's still early, wheedled Gino Sadler.
He and B. Arling stood at the side of the dance floor. The back of his neck dripped perspiration, but he wasn't ready to quit just yet.
Charles isn't coming, B. If he was, he'd be here by now. I'm a far better catch than him anyway.
And so modest, too, joked B, pinching his cheek. Just one more drink, then, she agreed, discreetly looking around for Charles.
What do you make of our friend Joseph? Asked Gino.
They both looked towards their table at the back of the dance hall where Joseph sat nursing a drink.
He's a sweetheart. But I don't think this is his scene. He's also more than a little drunk. Just like you.
I may be drunk, but it's because I'm in love, said Gino.
Who's the lucky girl? Teased B, patting her newly cut bob and fluttering her eyelashes. Come on, B, you know how I feel. I'm head over heels in love with you.
In love? Goodness gracious, we've only just met. You are a funny chap.
Well, I'm certainly a little in love, and I insist we have one more dance.
I can't. This new Charleston's exhausting. My legs are so tired I feel like my feet are about to drop off.
Oh, come on, please, just one more. Be a sport.
Don't you think you should be getting Joseph home?
Maybe, but only when you and I have had another dance. I really don't want to return to my pokey little flat and listen to Joseph wittering on all night. Again.
B sighed and smiled. All right. But first, I need that drink you promised me.
But it's only to save you from Joseph. He does look unusually down this evening.
Gino's face lit up.
You're an angel.
Sent straight from heaven, B laughed. He took her hand and recklessly spun her round a couple of times. She almost careered into a waiter carrying drinks and giggled her apologies. B gave Gino a playful poke with her finger.
Don't go getting any ideas, though. One drink, one more dance. I've no intention of going any further with anyone. I'm young.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.